الحمد لله رب العالمين الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين شفيع ذنوبنا وطبيب نفوسنا وحبيب قلوبنا أبي القاسم محمد. وآله الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين وأصحابه المنتجبين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. أما بعد، السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. With the approach of the month of Ramadan, we face and find ourselves presented with another grand opportunity to make something of ourselves in this life of ours. In the month of Ramadan, it is stated that we are the guests of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah is our host. And it does not befit the host not to grant the guest whatever the guest demands. Now, this is the beautiful nature of Allah. He has created us, as it states in the Quran, in a state of weakness. He also declares that man is ignorant, arrogant, makes haste, and filled with plentiful mistakes. But as a very caring parent, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows that the end game is the success of this human being for whose sake he has made this world and gone to the trouble of sending so many prophets, has gone to the trouble of seeing the well-being of the human beings, and therefore he understands very well and knows very well that the success of the human being is the utmost goal that he himself desires and that the human being desires. So as a very benevolent, caring, loving parent, what Allah chooses to do is, as opposed to reprimand, he decides to forgive, to give a second chance. The month of Ramadan is that giving of a second fresh chance to the creatures so that they may be encouraged to do good. And this makes a lot of sense, because if we were to reprimand the child continuously, the child would lose confidence altogether of attainment of any good or success. The only way we can get a child back on the road to success or to attain is to forgive the child and to encourage them to do good, to point out to the child that you are worthy of something great. Not all is lost. Give it your best shot. Something can come of it. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does with us on every occasion, but most prominently in the month of Ramadan. So the hadith is this, for the month of Ramadan and for the day of Arafah. For example, Imam Sadiq salamullah alayhi states that on the day of Arafah, the greatest sin a person can commit is to presume that they have not been forgiven. For when the Lord says, if you were to make it on the plains of Arafah, then I will forgive you, then it is a form of audacity to presume that the Lord hasn't forgiven. Even if I am unworthy of forgiveness, it is He who has said, I will forgive. And it is unbefitting for me, therefore, to think otherwise altogether. Similarly, in the month of Ramadan, as our scholars state, that is it possible that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala were to invite you to a banquet, that you be a guest of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that you leave the presence of God without Him granting to you whatever you seek of Him, where He Himself says, Ud'uni astajib lakum, call me and I shall respond to you. Now, is it befitting of that sort of God to not to grant you whatever you ask of him. Furthermore, the du'as teach us to state these words, وَغْفِرْلِ تِلْكَ الظُّنُوبَ الْعِظَامِ. Forgive us those grand sins which none but you can forgive. They teach us to state that, O Lord, rectify for me all my affairs. They teach us to state that, O Lord, if you have not become pleased with us thus far, then in whatever remains become pleased with us. These are instructions given through by God through the words of his prophet and the imams, in order to convey to us that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving us this opportunity to get ourselves forgiven. Not only forgiven, but there is another message that Allah gives, that you can be forgiven by me, presume yourselves free of any fault, for indeed the hadith says that the most wretched of the soul is one that does not become forgiven by the end of the month of Ramadan. And it is not possible that the soul would not become forgiven or would not be forgiven by the end of month of Ramadan. We go to that extent in the literature, goes to that extent in conveying this merciful aspect of Allah. But that's not the only thing that Ramadan conveys to us. There are a host of other things that Ramadan conveys to us. Forgiveness is the fundamental, the primary one. Beyond forgiveness, what the month of Ramadan teaches us, as conveyed through the communications of God within the Quran and through the words of the Prophet and the Imams in their supplications, is that now you are witnessing the month of Ramadan. Become mindful that you are not ordained with bearing the burdens of life in the way that you presume you are. The world is a place that is fixed. You will be challenged, you will be faced with challenges. Your only task is, through these challenges, to find your God. When you find that these challenges are becoming overbearing, then at that point become mindful, this is what the du'as teach us, to shift these burdens and stresses to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and free yourselves of the stress and anxiety, the fear, the discomfort that they are causing you. So now in the month of Ramadan, there is a beautiful process of growth. One is, O Lord, forgive me. Make me eligible that I can call myself your servant, your slave. Two, bring this understanding to my mind that whilst you are my Lord, I am not to lose sleepless nights worrying over the affairs of this world of mine. They are in your control. Allow me to free myself of these shackles that tie me down. On that note, just for a few more minutes, what actually causes me fear and anxiety is not the situation outside. That is just a situation. What really causes me anxiety is how I'm interacting with it. What causes sleepless nights is not the situation that I'm facing, but it is how I'm interacting with that situation psychologically. Now you find the soul like Imam Hussain Salamullah Alayhi, who is smiling amidst unsheathed swords that are cutting him up. He smiles. Danger is real. He's going to be killed. But his attitude is this, that if my God has destined for me to die in this way, I will not be able to flee from it, I will die. And therefore, give this negative relation to this situation that brings about fear, anxiety, sense of loss, lack of control, give it away, because Allah has not destined control for me in this situation, in the physical situation. He has given me control from within. I will control myself and be dignified about it. For a man to smile at that point says something. Or for Ali ibn Abi Talib to sleep on the bed of the Prophet at the night of Hijrah, to the extent that the verse says, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَشْرِي نَفْسُهُ ابْتِغَاءَ مَرَضَاتِ اللَّهِ, and praises him to this extent. What does it show? That the danger is there, but his interaction with that situation is a very positive one. The month of Ramadan actually teaches us this through its du'as and supplications and through the communications of Allah in the Quran and through His Prophet and the Imams, that the month of Ramadan is a month for you to become mindful, to place these burdens upon the shoulders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and free yourselves. Free yourselves to attain your objective of growing in your godliness and humanity. What lets me down in this world are my aspirations. If I do this, I will attain this. If I do this, I might not attain this. On the other hand, a soul in the month of Ramadan is reconditioned to thinking that whatever is destined for you will be attained by you. God will not shortchange you. He will not shortchange you. Make your decisions to the best of your ability and leave it up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but don't waste your time thinking, rethinking about the situation. If you find that this is the best decision you can take for the sake of Allah, then take that decision and go for it. Whatever is destined for you shall come to you. Doesn't the literature teach us? Ar-rizq rizqan talib wa matlub. Sustenance is of two types, the one that is sought and one that seeks you. The one that you seek, if it's not destined for you, will never be attained by you, no matter how far you traverse. And the one that seeks you shall find you. You can never flee from it. So these are the beautiful teachings of the month of Ramadan. One, Allah is the forgiver. Two, free yourselves through Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make this month indeed a profitable and a beneficial month for all of us. Can we remember our marhumin and the marhumin of this beautiful humanity of ours with the Surah Fatiha? بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وآله الطيبين الطاهرين أما بعد السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته. Continuing from the last khutbah, from the first khutbah, and then going on to a very pertinent theme which we will discuss for a few minutes. The greatest that the human individual can achieve from life is a share of godliness. Whatever else apart from God is there is not to be attained, because it has no permanence within itself. Needless to say, and these are mundane sort of examples, the buildings we will not take with us into our graves. Indeed, the bodies have begun their decline in this world, let alone turning into dust and becoming food for the creatures that await us within the grave. I take nothing with me of this world. I do not take you with me, nor my books, Even the gray matter shall, prior to its eventual decay, begin to forget whatever it knows in this world. And Allah says in Surah Hajj, and from them, from you are those who die early, and from you are those who we bring to such an old age that they don't even remember what they knew initially. So the only thing we take with us is our share of godliness or our share of God. That's the only real thing that is there in this world to be attained. Now, the pagans honored sacredness of certain months. In Surah Tawbah and other surahs of the Quran bear witness to this, that in Ashhurul Hurum they did not fight. Now, for us as Muslims, one of the sacred months is the month of Ramadan. In addition to Dhul Hijjah and Muharram and others, Ramadan is a sacred month. The Muslims in this month are not to think of harming the other. In the rest of the months, they should not be harming anybody, but especially in this month, they should not harm anybody. The situation that is unfolding in Iraq and that we are witnessing on a daily basis is not a situation befitting a Muslim. No, it's not befitting a human being. Leave aside a Muslim who is endowed with spirituality and godliness. ISIS and the way they are killing people is unforgivable at a human level. The way in which they have taken the Yazidi daughters and sisters of ours into slavery to sell them off is barbaric. It cannot be accepted. In return, the way the Yazidis and the Shia militia, as we read by reports from Amnesty International, are going about killing the Sunnis is equally reprehensible, inhumane, and unforgivable. If you read the accounts of the Yazidis and some Shia militia going into villages and shooting 70, 75-year-old men in wheelchairs, dragging out 12, 17-year-old boys and shooting them in their heads, and their mothers running out to find holes in the heads of their 12-year-old children and thrown by the garbage, this is unacceptable. It is fueling the sectarian tension even more. What we see from here is a total decline of human worth and value, a total decline of spirituality. I often think to myself that in this evolutionary track, the world is becoming more moral and more God-centered. Even through the guise of secularism, it's becoming more moral, to be quite honest with you. And if that's the case in theory, then what is this that we are finding in practice? It doesn't add up. Upon analysis, I always find that it is a very few of these world that are bringing about damnation for the very many. The majority of the people are good people. They are good people. But due to the few, they are becoming damned totally. The Bush, the Blairs of this world, the Netanyahus of this world, and the ISIS of this world, they have ruined it for the 7 billion good souls of this world. I don't know now, at this point in time, what we ought to be doing, apart from قُلْ أَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَهْلِكُمْ نَارًا, Allah says, or you who believe, save yourself and your near ones from the pit of hell. What else can we do? Who is there to listen to this? So is this what we do? Or kun fil fitna kabni labun, la zahrun fayurkab, wa la dar'un فيحلب, as Ali ibn Abi Talib said. In tribulations, become like that tender-backed camel, young camel, who does not have a back so that anybody can sit upon it, nor others that anybody can milk it, i.e. become in a state that nobody can take advantage of you. Is this what we are duty-bound to do in this world of ours at present, where no hope is left for rectification of the situation, despite the fact that people are good, but they have been hijacked by the few? That now the Yazidis will kill the Sunnis, and Sunnis will bear this grudge against the Shias and the Yazidis, and go on and on and on, and spread to every corner of the world, and then become a clash of the civilizations that stated in the 90s, which was created by this article or other people, and there is no such thing as clash of civilizations? It doesn't even make sense to me, to be quite honest with you. Are we supposed to do this? Just become passive? Or should we look at the example of Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and have that grand resolve in the face of the impossible and do the right thing that befits the state of humanity? He was a single person faced with similar situations. In his individual capacity, he strove. He had utmost resolve. Instead of talking about revenge, he spoke of forgiveness. He spoke of a loftier purpose. He converted monsters like Netanyahu, who belong in the pits of hell, monsters like Blair and Bush, monsters like ISIS, and made them into humans. As a result, created a civilization. From a point of ISIS-like existence that the Arabs had, you know the Arab existence, cutting heads left, right and center, burying daughters, offering male sacrifices to stones and Lat and Uzza. From that state, the ISIS state, where there were people like Bush and Blair exploiting the whole situation, and Netanyahu's of their own, to a state in which he creates brotherhood, united in striving for the ultimate goal of humanity in becoming godly. On the one hand, when I look at the situation, I say, قُوْ أَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَهْلِكُمْ نَارًا. That's all you can do. On the other hand, you see the great Prophet of Islam single-handedly changing the fate of the world. I will say this, that the heart finds no peace and rest in saying to itself or consoling itself by saying, save yourself and your near one. No, it finds no peace. It feels a burden of responsibility. I feel this month of Ramadan, we in every capacity possible spread the message of God, love and peace to the best of our capacity and ability. Leave the rest to Allah and let Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make the difference in His own way. But let us not stop striving to do good and to rectify the situation in whatever capacity we are. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Wassalatu wassalamu ala ashrafil anbiya'i wal mursaleen wa alihi at-tayyibin at-tahirin. Amma ba'd. Allahumma salli wa sallim ala Muhammadin al-Mustafa. وعلى علي المرتضى. وعلى فاطمة الزهراء. وعلى الحسن المجتبى والحسين الشهيد بأرض كربلاء. وعلى علي بن الحسين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد. والحسن الحسن بن علي وحجة الله بن الحسن القائم المهدي المنتظر. اللهم عجل فرج وسهل مخرج واجعلنا من أنصاره وأعوانه والمستشهدين بين يديه. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر.
اللهم صل على محمد.